much for coming.
You okay?
And I feel that I am the last person in the world to be giving a talk about the Klondike. As it happens, Lynn and I spent quite a lot of time there last summer and got very interested. And I'm going to tell the story of what it looks like from the outside, and then maybe we'll see what it looks like from the inside. First of all, I want to pass this map around the table. I'll hold it up first. Klondike is like the state of Idaho in shape, only twice as large. And it extends all the way from British Columbia to the Arctic Ocean.
You mean Yukon?
To Alaska on this side, to a brand new province in Canada called Nunavut on this side, used to be the Northwest Territories, to Alberta down low. And over here we have a very interesting thing. You all know that Alaska has a panhandle. You probably don't know that it extends almost half of the way down British Columbia. So that Alaska, in fact, covers part of the Yukon Territory and part of British Columbia in this narrow strip of land. And the climate and geography are extraordinarily different between this point and this point, as I'll tell you as we go. And I don't know if you can see that very well, but you can pass it around and look at it while we talk. Okay, we're here to start with to talk about a gold rush. And North America's first gold rush was not in the Klondike, but in North Carolina in 1799, and 30 years later, again, it was followed by the Georgia gold rush, neither of which you probably ever heard about, and neither of which seemed to have any place at all in American history. When you think of gold, you never think of the South. You think of the West or California. And the Klondike wasn't even the first famous gold rush. The first famous gold rush was the discovery of nuggets at Sutter's Mill in the Sierra Nevada of California in 1848. And a year later, 300,000 people from the US, but also from South America and Asia, found their way to Eastern California. The 49ers reached California by sailing ship, covered wagon, faced hardships on the trip. The great majority were Americans. And gold, worth tens of billions of dollars in today's money, was eventually recovered from that California gold rush. It gave great wealth to some. But come in and be comfortable. Pull up a chair sitting right next to me.
So you have two, it's three of you, right?
Yeah.
Jeff, if you don't mind.
Someone else come?
Yep. There you go. Hello,
welcome.
Hello.
You're not too late. We just gave a quick introduction to the idea of gold rushes, and we're now in California.
Did Marshall, when he found the gold, when he found the gold in Sutter's Mill, did he say, don't tell anybody?
No.
Is that why only 300,000?
Yeah. It was a well-kept secret.
You can't keep your mouth shut if you're a gold miner, as you'll see shortly. One of the unintended consequences of the gold rush in California was, first of all, that only a few people found gold. But secondly, others found something they weren't looking for, the richest agricultural land in the world. And within a year, California had not only been settled and farmed, but it became the 31st state of the Union, all in one year. Mm-hmm. 50 years later, and now we're in the Yukon, in 1896, the last of the great gold rushes took place in the Klondike River Valley. And it was later immortalized in the books of Jack London, Charlie Chaplin's Gold Rush, if anyone's seen that. In the poems of Robert Service, one of which I may have the to Meredy to read. Most people think the Klondike, the forested hills of the Klondike River Valley, are in Alaska. But the truth is, they are entirely within the Yukon Territory, Canada's most northwesterly province, and its immediate neighbor to the west is Alaska. Needless to say, with the exception of a small strip of the Yukon along the Alaskan Panhandle, the climate is either Arctic or subarctic. What that means is there's permafrost under the ground every day, every month, all year. Yukon holds the record for being the coldest place in North America. In 1947, thermometers in the since-abandoned town of Snag, Utah, dropped to a record low of -81.4.
At what time of year? What month?
Didn't say the month, but I imagine January or February is pretty close. That's why they left town, I'm sure.
They're still in the permafrost. They never got out.
As I said earlier, Yukon Territory is roughly the shape of Idaho, more than twice as large. Idaho is the seventh least densely populated of the 50 states, with 20 people a square mile. The Yukon averages one person every 5 square miles.
Wow.
28,000 of those people live in the city of Whitehorse, and the other 6,000 are spread between 7 towns and 186,000 square miles.
Oh my God.
We did a 400-mile drive from Whitehorse to Dawson City, and it's virtually a deserted road. I'll tell you about that. On our drive to the Klondike along a nearly deserted road from Whitehorse to Dawson, we came across what at first looked like a wolf cub, a black wolf cub. It was still there in the mirror, so we backed up to have a look. And the cub, which we later determined to be a full-grown rare black fox, not only didn't run off, but warily circled our rented Subaru station wagon, staring at us and sniffing the air with caution, but no apparent fear. In the end, we left him there as puzzled as we were, and we guess that we may well have been amongst the first persons he ever saw or had an opportunity to meet. Empty as it may be, however, what the Yukon has had plenty of before the stampede was gold and those who sought it. Prior to the discovery, hundreds of prospectors, of whom some were sons of the people who went to California and settled in California, started panning the creeks in the Yukon years earlier than the actual gold rush. Though controversy still exists as to who made the actual discovery, it is agreed that 4 men sparked the stampede. George Carmack, an American whose father had prospected for gold in 1849 in California. Carmack's 2 Tagish Indian partners, Skookum Jim and Dawson Charlie, and a prospector from Nova Scotia named Robert Henderson. Carmack and his 2 partners were prospecting in the creeks near the junction of the Yukon and Klondike River. No one imagined that their lost corner of the wilderness would, in fact, be a city of 30,000 people 1 year later. But on one summer evening in August of 1896, Henderson stopped by to tell Carmack that he had found some colors while panning in Gold Bottom Creek earlier that day. And Carmack, as was the custom, asked if he could stake a claim nearby. Henderson replied that he was welcome, but his Indian friends were not. Several days later, both Carmack and his partners visited Henderson to see the colors for themselves, but they came away less than impressed. In fact, during that brief visit, Henderson went on to offend both Jim and Charlie by refusing to either give or sell them any tobacco, a prejudice that would soon cost him a fortune. Carmack and his partners returned to their camp via Rabbit Creek, a tributary of the Klondike River, in which they too had previously found some colors. And it was then and there, on August 16, 1896, that one of them found the nugget which sparked the Great Stampede. While Carmack always maintained he saw it first, his two partners agreed that it was Skookum Jim who had spied the nugget. But after years of prospecting together with mixed results, they all agreed that it was the largest nugget any of them had seen, and in searching further, they found even more nuggets just lying between the nearby rocks. They were also quick to agree that if their claim was registered in the name of an Indian, it would not be respected. So the next morning, Carmack and Charlie went to Dawson City to register several claims in Carmack's name, while Jim stayed behind to guard the site. Other nearby prospectors, of course, soon heard the news, and in short, the humble Rabbit Creek became Bonanza Creek. And by the time that the standoffish Henderson, who continued to work his meager claim on the other side of the hill, found out what Carmack had discovered, the entirety of Bonanza Creek had already been staked. A bitter Henderson convinced that Carmack's discovery had been the result of his disclosure, he claimed Carmack had welched on his promise to keep him informed of any finds to enable him to stake a claim as well, and many Canadians agreed. 2 weeks later, two weeks after Skookum Jim had spied that nugget, a claim was also staked on El Dorado Creek, a tributary of Bonanza Creek, which proved to be even richer. And by end of the month, many of those claims were already producing gold. Word reached Circle City, Alaska, a log cabin metropolis on the Yukon River, that was the winter quarters for most of the area's prospectors. There was already snow on the ground, but many more miners departed by dog sled for the Klondike the next morning. During that first winter, those miners found millions in gold, and when the Yukon River ice broke in May of 1897, Circle City was virtually depopulated. Every prospector in the area was headed to the Klondike. Now, Klondike's a long way from the rest of the world, and though the news traveled from creek to creek, it wasn't until the summer, a year later, that two nearly simultaneous events brought the dream of easy riches to the rest of the world. On July 14, 1897, the steamship Excelsior arrived in San Francisco with $500,000 worth of gold from the Klondike. And 3 days later, when the steamship Portland docked in Seattle, 68 miners unloaded $1 million worth of gold in front of an awed crowd of 5,000 people. Their wonder stories of the Klondike were finally broadcast to the world. Now, there are three ways to get to the Klondike, and I'm going to pass this around, but essentially, you can walk through Canada, totally uncharted wilderness, Indian trails if you can find them. You could take a steamship all the way through the Pacific, up through the Bering Sea, and 1,500 or 2,000 miles up the Yukon River to Dawson City.
If there is
first
a
first trip,
if there's
I'll pass that around now. The first route through the wilderness of Canada was really not an option for most prospective prospectors. It was sheer wilderness, it was wild country, and it was uncharted and unmapped. The second route, which was a combination of boat travel up the inside passage from Seattle to Skagway, Alaska, a city in the Panhandle, then on foot from Skagway up through the mountains to a chain of lakes which were the headwaters of the Yukon River, and then by raft or canoe or whatever you could get down the Yukon River 1,000 miles or so, actually it was less than 1,000, to Dawson City. Now, the first route was too difficult. The second route was the shortest and cheapest. The third route by steamship was absolute comfort, but the people who had that kind of money didn't really need the gold. So 6 weeks after those steamships arrived in Seattle and San Francisco, Dawson City had 10,000 new residents. In the next 2 years, the stampede would embrace 100,000 hopefuls, mostly from the U.S. and Canada. Who were they? We don't really know. We do know that about two-thirds of that number never actually made it to the Klondike. For the most part, only those who got there early actually struck it rich. A miner named Oliver Millett of Lunenburg, Nova Scotia, staked a single claim high above Bonanza Creek that produced for him alone $500,000 in gold. But he was not by any means typical. The first army of miners, including Jack London, the writer, that got off the boat in Skagway during the fall of 1897, not only had no prior mining experience, but they had no idea at all of the clothing, tools, and food supplies they would need to survive. These archetype greenhorns also did not understand that they were about to embark on the longest, most difficult, and most dangerous journey of their lives. And when they understood what would be required of them, many of them quickly reboarded the boats that had brought them. Those who imagined they had the fortitude and wherewithal to continue were forced to purchase the food and supplies they had neglected to bring with them at exorbitant prices. You know, as an aside, the people who really made money in the gold rush were the storekeepers, saloon keepers, hotels, Chinese laundries, whatever, who serviced the miners.
Including the women.
Mm-hmm. So many of the earliest stampeders had been caught without the necessary clothing and supplies that they became beggars, thieves, or died. And the Canadian government soon required that stampeders must bring with them 1 ton of goods, a year's supply of food, 1,000 pounds, and another 1,000 pounds of clothing, equipment, and mining supplies.
How would they carry it in?
Pardon? That's the fun part. How would they carry them in?
Well, that's where it gets very interesting. Now, the first leg of the journey to Dawson City, after you got off the boat, was a long, steep, and narrow foot trail rising 4,000 feet above the sea. And I'll get to that in a minute.
I'm just teasing.
Through one of two passes between Skagway and the border, and then another 30 miles in fairly open country to the headwaters of the Yukon. Now, the initial ascent was too steep and narrow for either wagons or draft animals. So the supplies had to be carried by foot and mule in cases in 50, 60 pound packs. And it took, you imagine, divide 1,000 by 50 or 60 pounds. It took between 30 and 40 trips for each miner to get his goods from Skagway, where he had to buy them, to the top of the pass, where the Mounties agreed to guard each miner's supplies until they went back and got the rest. There were professional longshoremen, if you will, on the site. The Indians figured out a very good thing. They charged by the pound, and working the market, they always found the miner who could afford to pay the most. Now, there is a picture circulating around this table that shows some miners climbing up a mountain. I'm going to describe that to you in just a second. The Indians' fees, by the way, changed as the weather changed. Ground conditions could make packing more difficult. Muddier ground conditions were harder to traverse and more expensive. In addition, travel through the pass was very slow. Every climber had to pass through an area known as the Scales, which was sheer ice most of the year around. They could purchase a ticket to use stairs that had been cut in the ice by the Indian guides, but travel was single file, the trail was crowded, and if you stopped to rest, is that the
yeah, that's
the
yeah. Walked over. Here's that, another, boy, here's another one here too.
Well, let me
so hold that's on up. Ice?
Yeah.
If you stopped to rest, and there were places to stop to rest, it could be an hour or more before you could find your place in line again.
And it was continual like that?
And
always that
if,
crowded.
Yeah. If that was not bad enough,
holy Christ.
It snowed so much in the cold weather that avalanches were a regular event through this pass.
Where people would and get killed?
Mm-hmm. Killed 50 to 100 people every time. Wow. However, because this was still the least expensive and the shortest route, the travelers persisted. At one point, the price of provisions actually took a discernible downturn because so many of the men who had packed the year's worth of provisions to the top of the pass decided they'd had enough, and they sold them to those who were at the bottom. Once everything was hauled to the top of the pass, it was still 30 miles to the headquarters of the Yukon. Lynn and I drove this route, and it's absolutely gorgeous and quite flat country. So the walking, I don't imagine, was too bad. It was where the border station is. And there were people there. There's another picture now here of, you see one with pack animals? Yes. This is the top of Chilkoot Pass. And there were Indians with pack horses and wagons that you could buy a ticket to ride from the top of the pass to Lindeman Lake, which is the head of the Yukon, headwater of the Yukon River. Some couldn't afford it. It's estimated that some people actually walked 80 miles for every pound of goods, for every pack of goods that went 1 mile. I don't know how, it seems improbable, but that was what was calculated by some for those who didn't have the wherewithal to buy a wagon ride or a pass. In the spring of 1898, when the ice on Lake Lindeman finally thawed, now there is a picture here of boats. Ah, yes. This is Lake Lindeman in the background, and by the shore are dozens of people quickly building boats. Those that couldn't afford to build a boat went into the woods, cut some trees, and made a raft. And when the ice finally broke, 7,000 canoes, boats, and rafts began their journey by water through a chain of lakes to the Yukon River to Dawson City. Yukon, by the way, is navigable for over 2,000 miles. It's a huge river. I don't think any of us in our normal education have any idea of that. I have a good friend that canoed it from Old Crow, Yukon Territory, to Fairbanks, Alaska, which, by the way, is also 2,000 miles. Said he would never do it again. It was later that year that Dawson became the largest city in Canada, west of Winnipeg. But that is not the most important fact. Of the 30,000 stampeders that finally reached Dawson, fewer than 4,000 less than 4% of the 110,000 that originally set out actually found any gold. Success rate, 4%. The easy gold, by the way, was panned out by the first arrivals. But because gold is heavy and over time sinks down to the bedrock below a stream, there was still far more gold in the ground than had been taken out. The next generation miners took to placer mining. Now, you all know what it is to pan gold. Placer mines basically do some excavating in the stream, force the water through a course of, I'll say, little waterfalls, and each time there's a hesitation because it's blocked by a little wooden dam. And there's a picture of a placer mine here. These guys here are doing placer mines. That's a sluice, and you can pass it around. And as the water runs through the sluice, there's a little bit of a stepped dam each way down the sluice, and the heavier gold is forced out behind those little dams. And by running as much water and material through that sluice as they can, they also were pretty successful in finding gold. But as they dug deeper, even with the aid of pressure hoses and bonfires, and we saw a picture.
Because of all the permafrost, it's all solid.
Where they managed to dig a hole down the hard way, and then they would build a bonfire and let it burn overnight to warm the bank of the wall that they had dug. And then they had eventually had steam machine driven high pressure water hose that they washed the bank down and got their gold that way. This process, as time went by, was increasingly difficult, increasingly expensive, as they had to go deeper and deeper. By the end of 1898, this is just a year now, the newspapers that had encouraged so many to travel to Klondike lost interest. And when news arrived in the summer of 1899 that gold had been discovered in Nome, Alaska, many prospectors left the Klondike for the new gold fields, and the population of Dawson dwindled to almost where it had been to start with. Population is now about 1,000. And that's what it's been for most of its life, with the exception of these few years. The city itself is a scrawny mud pile on the side of a mountain. The Yukon River is on one side. The Yukon River is huge. It floods. And at least once a year, downtown Dawson was underwater. They built a dam since then, and the boardwalks that were necessary to get through the mud in the past are mostly gone, but the city today still doesn't seem very far past what it must have been in around 1900. There are a few places that are restored, but there are many buildings without paint and fairly dilapidated. It's being, what's the word, gentrified slowly, I would say. Very slowly.
What time of year were you there?
Pardon?
When were you there? What month?
We were there in late August.
Labor Day is actually when we were.
And right, was there snow on the ground?
No, it was cold. People were beginning to wear parkas. If we did it again, we'd go 2 weeks earlier. But it was comfortable. It wasn't bad. By 1903, the gold rush was history. And for a few years, nothing happened. But everybody knew there was more gold in the ground. But its depth made it impossible to remove. The invention of the gold dredge and the trommel would enable the excavation and mining of far more gold-bearing soil in far less time at a far greater depth. Now, a trommel is, in essence, a very large forged steel pipe holed out to be essentially a filter. It's like a big, round, circular tube screen. They can be 30 feet long and 5 feet in diameter, and they rotate. The gravel and the dirt and the gold and the water are poured in from the top, and as this thing rotates, it separates the heavy material gold from everything else. And there, I'm going to pass around a schematic drawing of a dredge. I will only say that the dredge has to float in water, but you can take the smallest stream, hollow out enough of it to have a pond big enough to hold the dredge, and the rest of the time the dredge does what it's supposed to do. A rotating line of cast iron buckets scoops out the ground in front of the dredge, runs it through the trommel, and pours it out back in a spoils pile. We were in stream after stream up there that were just hill upon hill of spoils pile with a little stream trying to make its way between.
Three drops.
And yeah. This is the schematic. You'll notice on one side is a spoils pile, on the other side is the ground to be dug.
And these things are huge. They were, what, four, five stories
these
high?
These things
they were
are
huge.
Reliant.
That they had to bring around. In the same way.
Here's a close-up of one
really?
Dredge. Brought they're built on the site. The castings, the forgings are shipped to them, and they build the dredge around the parts they receive. This shows the buckets, the clam buckets, on the snoop of the dredge, and they just rotate. They come from the bottom and pick the stuff up, take it back into the machine, dump it in the trommel, and keep going. The gravel, the gold-bearing gravel, is fed into the trommel with water. Water is what enables it to move down through the spring. So these things had a pump and an engine that drove the trommel and the scoops all over Dawson City.
And nobody's complaining about it?
Pardon?
I just find it amazing.
There's still money for gold everywhere. Every stream we went, there were still little mini things going on. Everyone's still
mining
for gold.
There's still people. If you've seen this program on TV, there are still people all over the Yukon and Alaska. A bulldozer, an excavator, a little trommel, still mining gold. But Now, the problem was that for a period of years, nothing happened after 1903, because even though the gold dredges had been invented, all the claims had already been staked. And the miners were mostly gone, some were still working, and the law provided that a claim would, in fact, expire after a certain period of time if it was not worked. But a claim that was worked would go on indefinitely, infinitely. Now, the Canadian government, well, let me not get ahead of myself. By the Act of Parliament, and despite the fact that many of those claims were still being worked, all state claims were deemed terminated in 1905. And the residual mining rights were sold off by the Government of Canada to those business entities with sufficient capital to pay lobbyists on the one hand. And to build and operate these new dredges. There were protests, fights, shootings by the original stakeholders, but the dissident miners were soon suppressed, and the gold was mined by these mechanical leviathans. We saw one of these in the picture. There's a gray one we actually visited.
Mm-hmm. That one?
No, but I'll come across it sooner or later. In any event, we walked around one. They're as big as they look in the pictures. And they operated in the Klondike. The last one was abandoned in 1966. although the first ones were steam-driven, the government of Canada, which, by the way, made a great deal of money on the taxes that they got from this, dammed one of the streams and built an electric power generator. And in a very short period of time, all of these dredges were operated electrically, with electric motors. And we're talking, by the way, this is not a big area in square miles. I didn't visit the whole place, but it seems like a rectangle that was 20 miles on a side would probably encompass this entire gold bearing area. That's not authorized fact. Now, that's the history, the superficial history of what actually happened. And if you read it and you just listen to it, you'd say to yourself, well, this was a huge failure, a human failure, you know? 100,000 guys, 4,000 succeeded. 4% succeeded. What about the other 100,000+? I said earlier, who were they? Well, one of the things that happens with great adversity is that people are forced to change. And they're forced to develop character, not necessarily good character. Good or bad character comes out of adversity and strength of spirit. One of the things that is hard to convey is the spirit of the people that did this. And earlier I said there were three people who in art tried to capture the spirit of the gold rush: Jack London, Robert Service, and Charlie Chaplin. Robert Service was a poet. We, in fact, visited his cabin on the hillside in Dawson. And he had come as a banker. Pardon?
He had come as a banker.
He'd come as a banker or insurance man.
Banker, yeah.
And ended up a famous poet. He captured one insight, one photograph of the spirit of the Klondike. And he wrote poems that were unlike anyone else's poems. And I'd like to read you a poem to see if you can get from it the feel of the people that actually lived and worked and died and loved and married and so on. It's called The Shooting of Dan McGrew. And it's a love story. It's about two men who were in love with the same woman. And in order to understand this story, you don't need to understand the word trauma, but you do need to understand that the word pinch means to steal. And the word poke is your bag of gold dust, okay? A bunch of the boys were whooping it up at the Malamute Saloon. How many have heard that line before? The kid that handles the music box was hitting a jagtime tune. Back of the bar in a solo game sat Dangerous Dan McGrew, and watching his luck was his light of love, the lady that's known as Lou. When out of the night, which was 50 below, and into the din and the glare, there stumbled a miner fresh from the creeks, dog dirty and loaded for bear. Some of these rhymes are a little forced, I admit. He looked like a man with a foot in the grave and scarcely the strength of a louse, yet he tilted a poke of dust on the bar and he called for drinks on the house. There was none that could place the stranger's face, though we searched ourselves for a clue, but we drank his health, and the last to drink was Dangerous Dan McGrew. There's men that somehow grip your eyes and hold them hard like a spell, and such was he, and he looked to me like a man who had lived in hell. With a face most hair and the dreary stare of a dog whose day is done, as he watered the green stuff in his glass and the drops fell one by one, then I got to figuring who he was. and wondering what he'd do. And I turned my head, and there watching him was the lady that's known as Lou. His eyes went rubbering around the room, and he seemed in kind of a daze, till at last that old piano fell in the way of his wandering gaze. The ragtime kid was having a drink, and there was no one else on the stool, so the stranger stumbled across the room and flopped down there like a fool. In a buckskin shirt that was glazed with dirt, he sat, and I saw him sway. Then he clutched the keys with his talon hands. My God, could that man play? Were you ever out in the great alone when the moon was awful clear and the icy mountains hemmed you in with a silence that you could almost hear? With only the howl of a timber wolf and you camped there in the cold? A half dead thing in a stark dead world, clean mad for the muck called gold. He's talking about a prospector out in the wilderness. While high overhead, green, yellow, and red, the northern lights swept in bars, then you've got a hunch what the music meant, hunger and night and stars. A hunger not of the belly kind that's banished with bacon and beans, but the gnawing hunger of a lonely man for a home and all that it means, for a fireside far from the cares that are, for four walls and a roof above, but oh, so crammed full of cozy joy and crowned with a woman's love, a woman dearer than all the world, as true as heaven is true. God, how ghastly she looks through her rouge, the lady that's known as Lou. Then, on a sudden, the music changed, so soft you scarce could hear, but you felt that your life had been looted clean of all that it once held dear, that someone had stolen the woman you loved, and her love was a devil's lie, that your guts were gone, and it was best for you to crawl away and die. 'Twas the crowning cry of a heart's despair, and it thrilled you through and through. I guess I'll make it a spread misery, said Dangerous Dan McGrew. The music almost died away, then it burst up like a pent flood, and it seemed to say, repay, repay, and my eyes were blind with blood. The thought came back of an ancient wrong, and it stung like a frozen lash, and a lust awoke to kill, and the music stopped with a crash. And the stranger turned, and his eyes they burned in a most peculiar way, in a buckskin shirt that was glazed with dirt. He sat, and I saw him sway. Then his lips went in kind of a grin, and he spoke, and his voice was calm. And boys, said he, you don't know me, and none of you care a damn, but I want to state, and my words are straight, and I'll bet my poke they're true, that one of you is a hound of hell, and that one is Dan McGrew. Then I ducked my head and the lights went out and two guns blazed in the dark and a woman screamed and the lights came up and two men lay stiff in the dark. Pitched on his head and pumped full of lead was Dangerous Dan McGrew, while the man from the creeks lay clutched to the breast of the lady that's known as Lou. Now, these are the simple facts of the case. And I guess I ought to know. They say that the stranger was crazed with hooch, and I'm not denying it so. I'm not so wise as the lawyer guys, but strictly between us two, the woman that kissed him, pinched his poke, was the lady that's known as Lou. Now, what I've wondered is that the guys that weren't in this bar, the guys that didn't find gold, all went somewhere. And the first thing you'd imagine is they either refused to go home or went home as failures. But today, for the first time, I thought, that's not necessarily so. That same adversity that had turned others to despair, ruined other lives, served, in fact, to make some people much stronger. And I suspect, and the book hasn't been written, that there are a number of lives that went through that hell and came out better than ever, gold or not. Our time in the Yukon.
Thank you.
That's great. Thanks.
Are any of the ancestors still there, Tony?
There's virtually no people.
Other parts of Alaska, there were.
In the Klondike itself, you know, as I say, we drove 400 miles and hardly saw any cars. Dawson has 1,000 or so people. There's really nothing there. It's likely that a great number of these same stampeders actually settled Alaska. The only people we ever met that had a history were people that had come to Alaska in the 20s and 30s and 40s as homesteaders, if you can believe that. The southern shore of Alaska gets the Japan Current. It's actually not much colder than here, but the light is a whole lot different, with the result that although the growing season is much shorter, the sun is out a lot longer and it powers those plants and you get, you know, cabbages this big and so on. One of the things I loved about Alaska is, yes, people live close to the ground still. They have freezers, they hunt, but you can catch salmon that are this big by just walking down to the nearest river. And it's a place where imported food is very cheap, but there's lots that's grown in Alaska and hunted and fished in Alaska. So it's kind of a gustatory delight from some points of view.
Now you mentioned the Klondike. We're actually visiting.
Say it again.
Where is the Klondike on the map?
Okay, that's a good question. And this, Seattle's down here.
Yeah.
These dotted lines represent current ferry routes. We rode on a ferry. We traced that route. And this is what the inside passage looks like from a ship. It's a real highway. And in fact, the company that owns this combination ferry boat and cruise ship calls itself the Alaska Marine Highway. Is that
right? They travel on it, yeah.
So anyway, you remember there was no way to get to Alaska by road up until the 60s. And there is still no way to get to Alaska by railroad. So you came by ship to Skagway. This is where it all began. This is Skagway is barely in Alaska. Mm-hmm. You go through a bit of British Columbia to get out of Skagway and then into the Yukon. That pass is right here. Mm-hmm. Right as soon as you get out of Skagway, you're on a flat a little while and you start going uphill. Once you ascend that pass, it's relatively flat from there all the way to Dawson, which is
up
right there, okay? So the Yukon River, by the way, also follows roughly that same route. It goes through this Lake LaBarge and Lake Lindeman, Lake Bennett, and winds through there and finally goes up here and out through Alaska to the Bering Sea.
It's where's navigable. The Klondike?
Pardon?
So where's the Klondike?
Klondike then? Is right there. There, the Klondike River, let's see if it's on the map or not. is not a big river. There it is, right there. Klondike River is there. The Yukon River is there. This territory between the two is called the Klondike.
So that's where all the gold
is. That's where all the gold was and is.
Not down in here.
No, no. It's over 1,000 miles from here to there. And
do they have a record, like, are the descendants, do the descendants talk about having, do they have a record of the descendants?
Yeah, I don't, first of all, I didn't meet any descendants, and everybody we met in Dawson seemed to me had recently come from somewhere else.
Okay. They don't really know what's happened to all those people, is I guess my question.
No, this is raw country.
Yeah.
You know, you don't go by highway markers and, you know, historical things. This territory is in winter 6 or 7 months of the year. There's only two seasons.
It's great they have these photographs.
Yeah.
Well, the truth is I had a camera full of photographs that are stuck in my computer.
Oh.
Or else we'd had a slideshow.
Yeah.
Man, what were you going to say?
I think one of the interesting things is, in particular, driving through here, there are lots of just signs along the way that this is where, you know, this was the beginning of where they did the boats or the little settlements and stuff. So you could, I mean, because this is what got us going, is it's like, oh my God, there's something happened here.
But you know, that's not the Klondike. That's just south of Whitehorse.
But that was the gold rush.
Whitehorse is the only real city in the whole province.
Now.
It's actually not a province, it's called a territory. There are seven other towns, each of which has not more than 1,200 people. So this is where the action is as far as the territory is
concerned. So did you guys start your journey and find this, or did you start with the intention of doing this?
This is the master planner.
I had planned the trip, but I did not realize it was going to be following the gold rush trail. That just sort of happened, and it was like, oh my God, you know, we're retracing someone else's steps here. This is how cool is that? Except we didn't do that hike up the mountain. Yeah. We stopped there. We got in our car.
I got to tell a story. I have a schoolmate who runs the fanciest Western tour business in the country. This is the real high-end stuff where you get to sit with Indian chiefs and the whole works.
Okay.
And when I knew we were going to take the kids out west, I called him and said, Bill, I'd like you to help us plan a trip. And he said, I'd be delighted. 3 weeks later, I had to call him back and say that my wife had told me that in no uncertain terms, she was planning the trip. And gracefully, not very gracefully.
I said, no way in hell is someone planning this trip I've been waiting so many years to do. That's what I said.
I learned, by the way, that she's an absolutely wonderful trip planner. And although we didn't have the kind of itinerary where you were going to be here on day one and stay in here and wait, we have hardly ever had hotel reservations. But we have followed the itinerary.
That's cool.
What did you fly into, like?
We flew to Seattle. Out of seven flights round trip, four were canceled. Mm-hmm. I had built an extra day in the trip just in case that happened, because the boat only leaves once a week. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to be there.
So that was
day
the
Alaska
early. State Fair, the ferry.
Yeah. So that was out of Bellingham,
right.
Washington.
Okay.
So that was 4 days up on the ferry
until
we got to Skagway.
Yeah.
It's a funny boat. The first two decks are like a ferry boat. It has cars and trucks. The rest of the deck have cabins like a cruise ship, except that the very stern open deck is covered with glass lucite ceiling. The kids who travel with tents and sleeping bags all set up their tents on the deck. And it's a real mix of elderly, retired, some wealthy folks, you know, kids, families, truckers.
Yeah, one of the trucks in the down below was filled with firewood. Yeah, it was.
There's no wooden.
They
Alaska.
Were making money. This is
somewhere. The geography is actually very interesting. This state, although it's shaped like Idaho, has mountains all the way up to the Arctic on the east, mountains on the west, and mountains in the south. The center is fairly flat. Taiga, T-A-I-G-A. It's essentially prairie, permafrost, scrub brush, not much in the way of trees. Mm. Quite beautiful in terms. We were there in the fall when bushes got red, and we drove from Dawson to Fairbanks. And the road is called the Top of the World Highway, and you go for 60 miles. There are no towns, no intersections, and you stay above 5,000 feet. You're on the top of ridges as you move through Alaska. Absolutely gorgeous, gorgeous highway.
Is that road paved?
It is partially paved.
Very little, but...
Very. Yeah. The first mile or two is paved. The next 50 miles or so are not paved. Yeah. Shortly before you get to the U.S. Customs Station, which, by the way, is 60 miles into Alaska, it's paved again. And once you get past it and farther into Alaska, it's not paved.
But it was a surprisingly good gravel road. It was very good.
A high-speed gravel road. Yeah. You could go 60 miles an hour on it if you want.
Did you do any research, or did anybody say why that was a place for gold?
There actually was, and I don't understand it, but apparently, like, right up in here was all a giant glacier that came down and basically stopped right in here. And so that was...
Everything fell out there.
Yeah, basically, yeah. It was everything fell out there. And it's not something I ever... took in school, so I don't really totally understand it, but I do.
Like, where did it, why was there?
Yeah. It's not part of the geology of that region. It came from somewhere else.
Yeah, yeah, because there really was something very unique about what had come in sort of from the northeast.
Mm-hmm. With the technology of today, do they still do the same way, or can they go in and mine now? Or? Going through the permafrost?
The pattern of gold deposit, as I understand it, is not deep veins running through the earth. It's gold that has been deposited from the surface, and because it's heavy, it's filtered down through the soil to the ledge or the bedrock. No further. If you watch these guys on the Alaska shows that are digging for gold, what they want to do is get down to the bedrock. So they test, they do a core. If they find the bedrock and find gold above it, that's where they'll mine. And people are still making fairly good money. It's more than day wages mining gold. I have someone a friend that used to live in Roxbury, Connecticut, hadn't seen him in years, ran into him in Stop and Shop, and I said, "Where have you been?" He said, "I'm mining gold in Alaska."
Well, with the price,
so I'm shopping at Stop and Shop.
Well, did you bring any back with you?
Well, he was driving a Jaguar.
We did not.
No. We fully intended to pan gold when we got there, and it just never happened.
And then made a little necklace. Yeah. I'm
personally not much interested in gold mining. Yeah. Period. You know. But
if you found a nugget like that, it would be.
Yeah. Well, the price of gold now, it's like worth it for the people to...
Yeah, there's enough gold. You may have seen the people vacuuming gold off the seafloor in Nome, Alaska. Hmm. That can be very, very lucrative. There's a young kid, he's 16 or 17 years old, who made more than $1 million last year mining gold in Alaska.
Wasn't there something...
I think
like 80% of the gold from Canada, comes from Dawson.
I'm sure
I think
that's
it was something
true.
Like that. It was a huge percentage of the gold is from there.
Would you go back?
I like Alaska.
Yeah.
I don't know anybody who's been there who said they didn't.
Was that your first trip? Pardon? It was your first trip?
He's been there before.
Actually, I was there
But not the same area.
I was there in 1964, about a year after the, no, excuse me, 1967, after the earthquake in Alaska. And I was there because one of the guys that I went with, father had a friend who ran a bank in Alaska, was going to find us summer jobs. Well, that didn't happen. But what we did do, seeing we were there, is we went and drove around them as much as we could. And they had just discovered oil on the Kenai Peninsula. And we drove down there. And on the way, we saw the railroad tracks that were all twisted up from the earthquake. But when we got there to where they were actually drilling for oil and gas, there was a tent city. It was brand new. People were living in tents. There were fishermen at a dock hauling fish on one side and people drilling for oil and gas on the other. And it was like, man, this place is popping. You know? Kenai Peninsula has since become, in many ways, the wealthiest part of Alaska outside of Anchorage. It's got some farmland. It's got plenty of settlers. It's much less wilderness than anywhere, except that's only on the edges of the peninsula, because the top is all a glacier. Best aquarium you'll ever see is in Seward, Alaska. It's got everything, ducks, birds, fish.
Did you see a lot of the northern lights?
We wanted to.
Oh. Never did.
But it didn't happen.
Were you not there at the right time?
Well, it's not a seasonal thing. It depends on solar storms. It changes the magnetic something.
We had heard we missed one the night before.
Oh, no.
But
I saw movies of
first
Northern Lights.
Oh, God, Northern Lights I ever saw was right here in Falls. I couldn't believe it.
Really? The first I saw were on Smith Hill.
Right in Lime Rock at the racetrack. Yeah.
Really?
It was the most gorgeous thing I ever saw, and I was right here.
How long ago? How long?
It was like 3 years ago. It just blew my mind. I couldn't believe it. I was just like, whoa. And the whole sky was like peach.
Yeah, it is amazing.
Yeah.
First time in my entire life.
Did you have a question? I can see you reaching up. Are you just adjusting?
Oh.
Well,
Tony, thank you.
Great adventure.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing.
It's a great pleasure. I had forgotten most of this stuff until I sat down and tried to write it down for tonight.
Yeah, it's amazing how small an area it really was.
Yeah.
I never realized that.
Yeah.
So. Now, Lynn, appreciate Peter is going to Alaska.
Yeah, June.
You are?
Are you?
June. Yeah, but we're doing a little soft trip.
What are you going to do?
19th of June.
Okay, that
for about 2 weeks.
That, you know, from mid June to mid August is probably the only time to go.
Yeah.
Do you know where you're going to go yet?
Yeah. I'm going to fly into Fairbanks. And
you are.
Go down to Denali and over to Anchorage, down to Seward, and get
be
on a
sure.
boat and go to.
When you
Vancouver.
Go to Denali, be sure you just don't go as far as the road goes.
Yeah.
You know, either get on one of their bus and stay inside, or hike.
Yeah.
Because I've always thought that Yellowstone was absolutely unmatchable.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it
Denali.
Is.
Denali.
Yeah.
Well, the thing is, you can't stay inside unless you go all the way to the end, and it's like $400 a night.
Right. That's why I said
they got you.
You can afford it.
Yeah.
That's.
Yeah.
The
bring your tent.
Yeah. Bring your tent. Love sleeping.
The colors. We were there for so-called fall colors, and the shrub birch trees were red and green leaves.
Yeah.
There were moose in the brush. Well, they could be from here to the wall away from you. You couldn't see them, and all of a sudden they were there. And you know, mammals are always bigger in the cold because they've got to have that bulk supply. Yeah. These moose have racks that you can put a couch on.
Yeah.
Actually, a couple of them had hammocks. Are you renting a car?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, we're doing the pretty soft.
Because Denali does have a thing, like a couple times during the summer, during the year, you can actually do a lottery, put your name in for a lottery, And there are like 2 days where you can actually then take your own car and drive all the way to the end rather than having to stop.
Yeah. You can go in 14 miles.
Yeah, that's, we're, there's some mile markers that we're going to on this little tour.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure how far in that.
It'll be worth it. Whatever you do, it will definitely be worth
it. Even if you take the bus, you will see bear and wolves and moose.
It's
very controlled, Denali. It's a big park. It's very controlled.
Denali is so big that when you enter the gate, the mountain is still 65 miles away, and you can see it.
Wow. Hopefully see it.
Hopefully.
If the weather's right.
We lucked out. We were able to see it pretty well.
And from the south on the road to Anchorage, there are also places where you can see Denali in the distance. But to do it justice, you've got to go inside.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I'll probably go back.
Yeah.
And do it a little differently.
I ended up walking the highway.
Yeah.
And once you leave all the cars behind, it's incredible how still
quiet
the wilderness is. Yeah. And you know, you're looking over your shoulder now and then.
Yeah. Nancy, who is next week?
Next week is Tom Schindler for the Galapagos. And then the week after that, which is the last one, are the kids who are back, came back from China, their China trip this weekend.
Did you say Galapagos?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'll have to come. I spent some time there when I was 18.
I've always wanted to go there.
Me too.
I worked on a fishing boat.
Off the Galapagos?
Yeah. The way you get your tuna fish in a can is that the entire U.S. tuna fleet goes from San Diego down the coast of Mexico, picks up herring and other bait food, straight across the Gulf of Tehuantepec to the Galapagos, fishes, fills up their holes, comes back home.
Wow.
Now, I mean, are we going to see you on the Deadliest Catch now? No. Is that your next adventure?
He's
going
to do the gold whatever it is.
I'll tell you, I ate pretty well on that trip. I didn't know tuna was a delicacy.
Yeah. A lot of good sushi.
Well, thank you
all for coming. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody, for coming.